Hello, hello, guys. Happy Wednesday. Thanks so much for coming in tonight. Hey, replay viewers, thanks for coming in. And hi, YouTube viewers. If you'd like to watch live, you can join me on Periscope. Just download the app to your phone and search for Penguin and Fish. I'm here every night at 9:30 p.m. Central. Hello, hello, everyone. All right, I'm going to flip you guys around. Hey guys, hope y'all are having a good Thursday. So we are going to continue on block 20. This is my oldest unfinished block. So I don't know if you guys remember this. I know we worked on this when I was at my parents' house a couple times ago. And I'm not even sure I have the videos uploaded from this yet. I think this was just when we were still only shooting Periscope videos, so I'll have to check to see if this is up. But yeah, old block 20. So we're gonna work on that tonight. We have a free day tonight since we got block 63 done really quickly. So all right, I'm gonna flip you around and we'll get going. If you're new here, my name is Alyssa Thomas from Penguin and Fish, where we make lovely and quirky hand embroidery patterns and kits. I'm the author of Sew and Stitch Embroidery and a fabric designer, and I'm here every night at 9:30 p.m. Central. We're embroidering tonight. Always fun. I love embroidering. So, all right, guys, let me know how your day went, and let's get going. All right. I am not sure we'll finish this tonight, which just pains me to say, but I think we'll get close. We might be able to finish, but I'm just not sure. All these are little, we can fill them in like with French knots or satin stitch or something, but regardless, both of those take just such a long time to do. So I don't know, we'll see. And there's a whole lot of little insects all around here too. It looks like there's not a lot left, but I don't know. I am wary to say, or hesitant to say, that we'll get it done tonight. So we'll see how we do. How about that? Oh, you just finished this one this week? Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, so after this one is done, I mean, there's quilting and stuff. Not quilting. There's piecework and stuff to do on this yet. This gets some corners, and I think it gets some cute edges, too, all the way around. So embroidery is only the beginning of this. I think you guys are just hitting the tail end of a thunderstorm that we got going on here. So if you hear, see a flash and then a giant boom, that's some lingering thundering here. The house isn't falling down. At least I hope not. So, all right, here we are. So let's see. We have all the flower and all the vine done, and it was basically only two stitches that we've used so far. So this is all the flower, and these little petals here, or leaves, are all satin stitch. And we kind of did it all satin. I mean, this was straight satin stitch, and then all the satin stitch kind of point towards the center there, is what it looks like we did. And then the leaves and the vine are all a whipped backstitch. And we did that yesterday, or not yesterday, 2 days ago when we worked on the bunny. It's basically just a backstitch, and then you go around each stitch with a loop. You just go loop around and around and around, spiral around it, and one for each stitch. And that's how we get this effect. But I think it looks like twine kind of sitting on top. Oh, you're done with yours? That's cool. Yeah, this is an old one. This is block 20, my oldest block. So, all right, so what we got left is this little butterfly and the little, like, stamen here, and we got three little ladybugs. In the design, she has the butterfly outlined, and I think I'm going to do that just for the sake of time. So let's start with the satin stitches. on the inside here. Okay, let's do this. These will be satin stitches. Let's do like a little chain stitch maybe for the body. And then, I don't know, maybe we'll do another whipped backstitch for this just to stay with the whipped backstitch look for the, well, I don't know, maybe we'll do it differently. Let's just do normal backstitch for the outlines of all these. But yeah, I think a little chain stitch in there would be kind of cute. So, all right, I have a few, it looks like we picked some threads already to use. So I think my guess is that we decided to use purple for the satin stitch. I think that would be pretty cute. We could actually just do him all purple. I kind of like that idea. Let's make him one color. Maybe we'll make the antenna a different color. I don't know, maybe not. But I like the idea of all one color. Then it's almost like a little moth. I think I'm going to do that. And it'll be easier for us to. So I'm going to get some thread out here. And I'm going to do that way of separating thread where I pull each strand out individually. I think that's been kind of working nice for me lately. So I am just going to grab one tiny thread from here. This is 6-strand embroidery floss. I'm just going to try and isolate one. That's two. I need just one. There we go. Oops, stuck. Okay. So now I'm going to hold just that one and pull. And it's super easy. And this is all released. It's not tangled at all. So let's do that with two more strands. I'm going to use... Oh, you know what? Have we been using 3 strands on this? I think we must be. Yeah, I'm guessing that I use 3 strands of embroidery floss. 3 is what I normally use, so I'm just comfortable with 3. The more strands you use, the thicker your stitches will be. And I just typically on my embroideries use 3 as my standard just because I like it. And this feels familiar to me, which makes me think that I've used 3 strands. So, all right, we'll set this one aside and we'll pick up those strands. So the theory is, and I haven't really tested this and I don't know if I'll be able to tell on this one, but the theory is that if you take the strands apart like this, your satin stitch will lay flatter. So I don't know. We'll see how that works, I suppose. All right, so I'm going to just show you guys the way I thread my needle again. Let's see if I can in focus here though first. Get my hand in focus. There we go. I think that's a little bit better. So I do the pinch technique. You can't really tell all that much with this purple, so hopefully it's all right. But I just pinch, like make a pinch motion like this, and I pinch until I can't see my thread anymore. And then I slowly unpinch my fingers, and the moment I can see the little tip of that thread or the floss, I'm going to put the eye of the needle right over it and kind of push down into it a little. And then I'm going to unpinch a little bit more, and it'll have just like a little itty-bitty bit of thread through it, but that's enough to grab it and pull it through. So, and it, you can get into a motion of doing that really quick after you get used to it. So, all right, I'm going to weave in my thread end to the back here, kind of where we're going to get started. I don't like to do knots in the back of my embroidery. I think they get in the way when I embroider, like my thread will catch on them, and in theory they come loose more easily in the wash and stuff. So I weave my thread in and out to the backs of other threads, back and forth 3 times to start and to end. All right, and then you can see you get a really clean back too. I don't have any frayed ends. I don't have any knots. So this is the back of the embroidery. It's great. There's nothing that my thread's gonna get caught on. It's super flat. No jumbled knots anywhere, no frayed ends flying around anywhere. It's just super clean, which makes it easier to stitch. Less knots, less tangling. All right, I'm going to start with just the satin stitch. And these guys are so small that it's going to be super duper easy to do. So what I'm going to do, I think for these middle pieces, I think I'm going to just do one long stitch all the way to the end. And then just put one stitch on either side a little further in so it gets that oval sort of look. And you know what? I don't think I'm going to go on the other side. I'll just do it with two stitches like that. I think that does the job well enough because we're going to be stitching around here too, and that's going to add some weight and bulk, so I don't think I need to add another satin stitch in there. So let's do the same over here. Purple will go just right with the rest of these crazy bright colors. This will definitely be the brightest block I think I have in the Splendid Sampler. It's pretty bold. Alright, I'm going to just continue with satin stitching for now, and then I'll do the other stitches. So I'm going to do this circle, I think I'm going to come up all the way on the right edge of this circle and then work my way this way across. So satin stitch, you're just going from one side to the other and then going back to the opposite side, just doing a couple threads, like one or two fabric threads over to do the next stitch. But you're always going from one side to the other. You're not zigzagging. You know what? Maybe this will go pretty quickly. I think for these stamen things, I think I want to do a bunch of French knots in there instead of satin stitch like this. I think that'd be pretty cute. And it just would feel like pollen almost, I think. So I think that I'm going to do that. All right, there's one. Let's do this guy down here. These will only take a couple stitches. Four or five most, maybe. Four, I think. Cute little dots. Well, I think you guys missed the thunderstorm. It's kind of too bad. It was really kind of loud and thundery, and it was just kind of neat. I don't think we've had a thunderstorm on Periscope here yet. You know what? I think I'm just going to get this done in three stitches. There, that's good enough. Three little stitches. Let's jump and do this side. I forget that I was gone yesterday. We didn't get any stitching done yesterday. Oh, and I was at my painting class last night, but just so you know, I am that t-shirt making class, or that, it's kind of like a three-quarter length top, I think is more like what it's supposed to be. That class is this Saturday, so I'm really excited for that. So Saturday night, I'll get to have show and tell with you. The shirt that I make in class. So I'm excited about that. We had talked about, supporting our local quilt shops and yarn shops and all that. The ones that are actually, nice. Like, not, we talked about how some of those shops, for some reason, which I don't understand, when you walk into them, they just treat you as if you shouldn't be there, or they make you feel bad almost, and I don't know why that is, but that is such a thing in the craft industry at some of these smaller shops, or boutique shops. But then you have the opposite too, where they're clicky or something. Yeah, I don't know, but you have the opposite ones, which are so amazing and really do everything for you and help you and all that. And those are the ones that you really need to, buy stuff from. And you know, we were talking about that, and I was thinking, you know what, I haven't been to the one by us in a long time. I'm going to do just a backstitch around here. And so after we had that conversation here, that night I checked to see what their class listings was like, and that they had this class for kind of a t-shirt, like a fancy t-shirt, like a three-quarter length thing, like a boat neck something, fancy to me. But kind of like my full-on wardrobe. Like, I would wear this kind of shirt, like, every single day, in theory. I have to, you know, we'll see what it looks like once it's fit and if the pattern is what I like once we're done with it or whatever. But that class is on Saturday, so I'm really kind of stoked about that. I have to drag my machine out there, my little, my hefty Sears Kenmore machine that we've been using here. So that'll be interesting. I don't have a case for it, and it is heavy, and, you know, I just have in my brain that, like, I don't know if they have a parking lot this place. It's kind of a little ways away, but not a ton of ways away, just further than the one that used to be here was, but they moved away. But I have in my head, like, the fear that there won't be parking, and I'll have to park, like, two blocks down and carry my giant heavy machine. Actually, it's not very giant, but it's heavy. And that'd be a long walk. You know, it would be a long walk from the parking lot to the door if there was a parking lot. I'm not sure there is. So we'll see how that goes on Saturday. I know all y'all who go to classes like this a lot, you know, you have all the nice carriers and stuff like that. But I don't have anything like that for my machine. No, I doubt he'll be coming with me. So it's a little ways away. So he'll stay home, most likely. Actually, I haven't asked him. Maybe he would want to come out. He could go to a coffee shop and work or something while I'm there. Put it in a small wheelie suitcase. Yeah, this might fit in one of our little wheelie suitcases. We only have, like, really small wheelie suitcases. I might give that a try. I think my guy might be just a hair too big, though. We'll have to see. But I'm so excited. That'll be fun. It's a class of something that I would actually wear. And it's working with knits, which I, you know, never do. Ever, really. So that'll be fun. And it's, you can bring your serger or your sewing machine, and I'm just bringing, I mean, I don't have a functioning serger, but I'm curious. I'd like to see, can I do this with just my normal machine with no bells and whistles, you know? I got my zigzag stitch and my whatever stitch. Let's see if I can do it with kind of like the minimal. So that's kind of, that's my plan, is to see how that goes. Sure, it'll be, you know, way easier if you had a serger to just whip through it and all that, but I'm on purpose making it hard for myself, I suppose, so I can learn. And, you know, so it can be something transferable here, because in theory, if it turns out like a nice, just, you know, simple, you know, three-quarter length sleeve knit top, then I would just make a bunch of those, and that would just be what I wear, period. You know what I mean? I would make, like, a black one, and a white one, and a colored one, and, you know, some pretty color, and then, like, some simple patterns that aren't too over the top, and I would just, like, make a bunch of them, especially, you know, in theory, I would think that it would go pretty quick, too. My guess is cutting takes the longest, and just figuring out, you know, what, like, figuring out the pattern so it fits you. But once you get that, I would think you could just pile these fabrics up. You know, I could cut, like, four t-shirts worth at once if I do four different fabrics and pile them up. Ha! And embroider a kitty on it. That'd be cute. But yeah, so, I mean, I could see making a bunch of these just to have. So that's the goal. That's the bright-eyed, happy hope for this class. If not, I know I'll learn a lot, though, because I don't do garment sewing really at all. I mean, I understand the concepts of it. Like, I've read about it and stuff, but I haven't done a lot of garment sewing. Yeah, I'm excited. And I haven't been to that shop in a really long time. So I'm happy for that, too. And I'm buying all my supplies for the class there. So I'll need, like, they gave us the class, the list. First of all, I'll need fabric, straight up, you know, knit fabric, which they'll have there. And then I need a blunted needle, and I'm guessing that's for the knits. Actually, I know that's why it is. It's kind of the same thing with how I say you wanted a blunt needle for cross stitch, because you don't want to pierce any of the threads in cross stitch. You want to go in those little holes. That's the same thing with like a knit fabric. I'm thinking you don't want to really pierce the little threads. You want to go in between them, in the little, you know, spaces that are made by the knit, would be my guess. I think two more stitches here. This is looking pretty cute. I kind of like him all one color, all just the purple. Here's what it's looking like from far away. Wow, it is really different with this back stitch, though, because we've been doing just this wrap back stitch. This really stands out. I've never seen sewn with knits. Oh, I'm excited to hear how it goes. Yeah, I've not sewn with knits in a knowledgeable arena with, you know, people telling me what to do, so I'm excited to see how that goes. Alright, I'm gonna do a chain stitch up this. I'm doing it the old way just because I think that's how my brain works, is this old way of chain stitch, and there's just three stitches, so I think we'll be fine. But you know what? I think I'm just going to do two stitches. We'll call it right here. Cute. Now here's that little anchor stitch. Just going over the top of that loop. There we go. All right. I'm wondering if I should do the same color for the antenna or not. So let's consider these for a second, because maybe that'll help make the decision. These guys are going to be two color. Oh, yeah, I don't know. I mean, you don't want to pull it super tight. I mean, just let them lay on top. All right, so these guys are going to be two color, so maybe I should make them two color. Maybe I can take, like, maybe a pink or something, like this dark pink. I think that's what I'm going to do. So let's, I think we're done with this purple. So let's weave it in. It feels so weird to work on this one again. It's been months, I think, since I worked on this embroidery. I mean, it's rare that we even get these little moments to work on blocks that we haven't worked on in a while. So I think, let's see, what do we got going on here? Oh, ideally I'd use some of my scraps, I suppose. So let's take this pink out of here. And you know what? I'm going to pick colors for these little guys already. Instead of getting more of the bobbins of thread out, or these little spools. Wow, there's a lot on this one. Holy cow. I must have two skeins on this one. But I have my crazy scrap bin. So whenever I finish a little piece of thread like this, I'll throw it. If it's usable yet, I'll throw it into this scrap bin. And I thought, you know, why pull out the stuff when I can probably find what I need in here? So what I'm kind of looking for is a black and, like, a red that goes with this. So this is, I think, going to be perfect right here. And it's already got three strands. So I'm looking at this for these little ladybug guys. And let's see, how should we do these ladybugs, really? Because I'm thinking that, you know, let's get up close here. So, maybe I should look at the instructions. Well, it looks like they've satin stitched the head in black and satin stitched the body in red and then put a bunch of French knots on top of the satin stitch, which isn't always the easiest thing to do because you're piercing through the satin stitch, which sometimes moves your pretty satin stitch around, but maybe we should give it a try anyway. So I don't know how else we would... Oh, we could just do an outline of red. Maybe that's what we should do. I think I'm going to do that. So I'm going to just... Let's just do a complete outline. So I'm going to just outline in red these three guys. And then maybe I'll satin stitch the little head in black and then do black antenna and some little French knots. Maybe we'll use just two strands for the French knots because I think our French knots with three strands are going to be too big for this. So, all right, I think that's my plan. I'm just going to outline this. I'm not going to satin stitch it with this. So this should be plenty of floss then for me. All right, so I wanted to just decide on that before deciding on this so we don't have some weird, crazy thing happening. And let's just find some black in here. Oh, that's hardly anything. I think we'll need a bit more than that. This is better. This can probably just go in my scrap bin that I'll throw in the Splendid Sampler. That's a little short to do stuff. Actually, you know what? I do little eyes on characters a lot, and this would be the perfect amount for a little eye. So there I am. I'm saving it still. So the other option is that we could do a different color than this black, because maybe we do something that implies black but isn't so harsh. Like, maybe we do just, like, a really deep purple or something. Because maybe that would go with my colors. Like, it comes out as a cube almost. It's a little ridiculous. Like, I have this really kind of dark blue. Oh, it's almost too dark though, isn't it? Let's pull it out. Just in case. I mean, we could do this kind of bright blue. Then I don't think it'll look like a ladybug though. Maybe black is the right way to go. Yeah, you know what? I think we just got to use black. I don't think it'll feel like a ladybug if we don't. Because ladybugs are so much black and red. I mean, this is kind of a navy. I guess this is a little brighter than a navy. I don't know if I have a good navy in here. I can't picture myself ever using, like, a nice navy color, which is kind of odd since I love that color. I must usually go brighter for my embroideries. Or lighter, I guess. Nope, I don't have any charcoal-y in here either. And I'm just trying to use something in my scrap in here. I don't want to go get, like, my thing that has all sorts of colors. I think we're just going to go black. That will be fine. Alright, so let's do this for the ladybug, and then wondering if we should use that same red for his antenna. I think that's too much. I'm going to bring back a color from in here. So let's go with that bright pink, which I now lost. It's probably on me somewhere. Oh, did I throw it in here? I might have thrown it in here. Is this it? Yeah, this looks like the same color. I don't think this is it, but it's the same color. So, all right, I'm going to use this for the antenna. Joys of floss. Yeah, this is my little secret pile of crazy. I just can't throw it away, like, these little pieces. And, you know, a lot of times you pull your three strands apart and, you know, you are okay with the one strand and then you're left with the three strands. So I keep all these. So let me just check. Yep, this has three strands in it. So I'm gonna quickly do those. Pile of crazy. And then for the stamen here, I think I'm going to do white for the stems and then like little white French knots. I think the white will just kind of stand out texturally, but not stand out a ton in the piece. And it'll bring in some of this white that's in the background. So I don't know. I thought that was kind of fun, maybe. Because we're going to fill these all in with French knots, I think. Yeah, a little subtle. Alright, so I'm just weaving in the back again to get my thread started. So I don't have the knots. I think I might do the whip back stitch for this, just to bring that look through a couple of the other elements, not just the vine. Okay. So, you know what? I think I'm going to start at the top of this guy, go down here, and then come back up like a V. And then we'll do the little whipped stitch around it. Yeah, it's just a neat texture. There's a lot of texture actually going on with this because we got the real satiny stitch here, which is just shiny. It's just flat and shiny. It stands off from the fabric. And this does too. The whipped back stitch just kind of looks like twine sitting like someone had that bendy wire twine that, and they just melded it into this shape. And then we have backstitch, which I think looks like a bunch of little shiny beads. Like you can see each stitch, they all stand out. And then we'll have French knots as well. And that'll give it a really, you know, that's definitely got its own texture. Yep, I've been doing that lately too, finding excuses to use the whip backstitch. It's just fun, and it's surprisingly fast. I mean, it is like, oh man, but I just did all that backstitching, and now I have to do more stitching on top, but the whip part of it is super duper quick. We're gonna go down this way. The last one. I'm gonna go in the same hole that I like this pink. I think this is gonna be cute. Same hole that we just at the top of that chain stitch. And you know, I mean, in one project you might want tons of different textures, and another project you might not, you know? So it's just another level of things to think about when you're doing your embroidery. Like, if you were doing all one color, you could have just, what would be so pretty is one color, like an all-white embroidery, but with tons of texture, like all different sorts of stitches. Something like that would just be super pretty. This one's kind of over the top, because we're going over the top with the color of the fabric and the color of these threads, and, you know, with the texture and stuff too, so this is just, like, a lot going on. I think that's kind of why I did all the same color for the butterfly, just to have, you know, a calming moment in here. So, you know, not everything's super crazy. All right, I came up at the start of this stitch now, and we're going to do the whipping around. So I'm not going through the fabric at all. I'm just going underneath the back stitches. I'm going from right to left and then back around again to right to left. Alright, and now we're going to come to a point, so I'm going to go into the hole there. And so now we actually have to come out of that same hole, but this is how you do that so you don't just pull out the stitch that you've already just done. So we're going to flip to the back, and we are going to just loop around some of the stitches that are in back here. Like making a stitch, kind of like what we just did, a whip stitch through the back. And now we can come back up through there, and it's not going to come out because there's a stitch holding it in place. All right, there we go. That'll do. So whenever you come to a corner, with whatever stitch you're using, if you're coming to a corner and it's a type of stitch that doesn't make corners well, because you have to come up at the same point, and you don't want the stitch to come out, just go to your back, loop it around of the back of a stitch that you already have there, and then come back up. Then you'll be good. As if you're starting a whole new row. Alright, I'm going right to left up here. It's just fast that with backstitch, but man, it's such a different look than a backstitch, though, isn't it? So then I'm going into the starting stitch of where we left off, the end of the stitch of that backstitch. But look, let's see if I can get in focus here. Just how different a backstitch is compared to a whipped backstitch. Like, look how beady this is. You can see every stitch, but this just looks like a twisted thread, like how yarn has that, you know, twist in that. It looks like it's just sitting right on top of the surface, a little twisted stitch compared to, you know, the beady backstitch there, which is kind of interesting. So we got four different stitches in this one tiny little embroidery here. It's kind of crazy. We got the whip backstitch, satin stitch, and the little chain stitches there. All right, done with that. Let's weave it in. Thanks. Yeah, I'm really liking how this is turning out. I wasn't sure about working on it again. I'm like, oh god, I'm not done with that one yet. And I was just like, yeah. But now that I'm doing this butterfly, I'm kind of like way into it again. It's one of those things, one of those examples of that motivation to do something happens 10 minutes after you're already doing it, or inspiration and motivation for something. Because, like, now I'm totally psyched up for it. Yeah, all the big things done. That's true. So now let's switch to our little dudes down here. So I'm going to do this red. It's kind of like a maroon, a brick red. Not even a brick red. It's brighter than a brick red. But I'm going to just do little back stitches around their backs, and that's it. I think that's plenty. And you know what? That's what we did for the butterfly, too, so conceptually it fits in with what we're doing here. And all we need is a little bit of that red color to get the idea, and then we'll just be doing a bunch of black French knots, and then black satin stitch, and little stitches for the antenna. So, all right. Let's get this going. Oh, I might have four strands in here. Yeah, I do. This, thought this seemed a little thick, so let's take one strand out. We don't need him. And I'm gonna just use these three strands as is. Alright. See, once you get that pinch method down, it's so fast to thread a needle. Alright, let's start all the way over in this one. I'm gonna weave in the ends again. It sounds all calm outside again, but I looked at the map and it said it was gonna rain until like 3 a.m. and it looked like we had some big red marks flying over the map. And we're in a flash, like the county that I'm in is in a flash flood warning until tomorrow morning at 7. So I'm kind of surprised that it's not still raining right now. Kind of weird, that weird weather. Okay, so I am gonna just stitch. The little arch around his back. Let's get the focus there. All right. With just a few back stitches. Oh, wow. So I did not do that thing. This is old, weird thread that I just grabbed out of my scrap bin. and I didn't do that thing where I pulled all the strands apart. It is doing some weird twist thing already, but luckily we don't have, like, look, it's trying to tie itself in a knot and stuff. Luckily, I don't need it for very long, because that would get annoying after a while. But I'm doing smaller stitches than what I did for some other back stitches, just because I want to get this tight curve, and the more stitches I have, the more, like, a curve it's going to look, the less, you know, like, square, diamondy it'll look. I want to give that illusion of a curve. I think we'll even do two more in here. Yep, a smoother curve. Yeah, I tend to, on the straightaways, go a little longer back stitches and then get a little tighter on these curves. You know what? I think I'm gonna add a couple more stitches just to get a little bottom out of here. Actually, I'm just gonna do one more stitch across, just so I have that red feel all the way around. There we go. Kind of like that. And now I'll do like those little French knots in there. Nope, the fabric solid won't come off tonight. I don't think I'll get done. I'll probably just get the ladybugs, maybe not even completely done. And then still got these guys to go. So nope, not tonight. All right. I think I'm going to weave in the background just to be nice and clean, but I'm tempted to go into the backs of all these stitches and then start up this one and then go in the backs of all these stitches and then start here. I'm not gonna though, because this is a really dark, bold thread that I might be able to see from the other side. If it was a white, like if I was doing this in white, I totally would have just gone in the backs of these stitches just to be like super lazy instead of having to weave them all in and start again. But since this is a dark color, I'll do it. We'll just weave it in quick and start the next one. But I'm tempted to just go across here and then jump to, I think the ladybug's like right there. But I think I might be able to see that from the front, especially since I don't have any buffer there. Good enough. Isolating these dark colors and in these spots here. So where's the next guy? Okay, down at the bottom there. So we'll weave it in there. I was tempted to be lazy there, but there's, you know, good reason not to do that. I don't want to see this on the front. Oop. Oh, I had a little knot there. All right, let's trim that. Cora, did you give those embroideries to your chiropractor yet? I think you might have said that you did already, but I can't remember if they liked them or not. Oh, I'm sure they did there, which is kind of cool. Cora did some embroideries that said snap, crackle, pop on them. Oh, she might not be in here anymore. I don't see her little icon here anymore. But she did snap, crackle, pop embroideries for her chiropractor, which I just thought was the cutest. If I was a chiropractor, I'd hang those in my office. All right, so I'm just doing the same thing, and then we'll do the little, hello, yep, we're doing the ladybugs. I'm going to do that stitch across the bottom, too, just to get more of this, you know, red. It's not really red. It reads as red enough, though, for our needs. It's more of a, we're going to do two stitches for this guy. one stitch just seemed a little long. Okay, and then one more of these way up on the top here. Okay, let's weave this in. Yeah, I think I'm gonna weave. I was thinking about weaving back across him, like in the back here, but we have all those French knots that we gotta put in there, so I don't wanna get that too bulky, full of thread back there, because it'll be harder for me to pull my needle through all that for those French knots. Okay, that's two. All right, where's the last one? Okay, right there. So let's weave into. So the back of this spine. It's fun to use scraps. I always feel good when I am using up scraps, even if it's just this tiny little piece here. Oh, just finished 36 of the 100 days, 100 blocks. Well, that's cool. Yeah, there's a bunch of, well, that's the Tula pink one. There's a lot of different quilt-alongs going on right now. Which is A-okay. All right, let's do this again too. Brand new embroidery for picks, not for quilt blocks. Oh, you back them with thin batting. Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah, for photos, that's a great idea. Because you're blocking any hint of a stitch on the back. You won't see any jumps at all. And that's actually that embroidery that's behind me, that big embroidery with the owl on it. That you can kind of see the bottom of when I start my periscopes. That's how I did that one as well. I had my front fabric and then a thin layer of batting, and then I stitched with yarn. But the thin layer of batting was so I wouldn't be able to see the stitches, and it actually makes a really pretty texture too. All the stitches look nice with that batting behind it. Oh, there's Cora. Hey, Cora, I was just talking about your snap, crackle, pop embroideries. Wondering if your chiropractor liked them. I thought that was just a fun idea. Oh, you're still working on them. Oh, funny. Yeah, so I'm not gonna do a satin stitch for this. I'm just gonna outline them in the red, just because I'm gonna be putting all these black French knots in there, and I thought just the outline, like how we did the butterfly here, would be plenty. So, and I don't always like the look of, stitching within satin stitch, because every time you, stitch something with satin stitch. See, it kind of splits the stitches apart, and you know, if I do my French knot, then it'll be split apart there and split apart here. It just makes the texture of satin stitch not so soft and nice. So I just decided to not do satin stitch for the red. All I need is a hint of red, and then we'll be doing the black French knots. Yeah, the whole point of satin stitch is that really satiny, smooth look. So doing anything to interrupt that, I think makes the integrity, it's getting caught funny, the integrity of the satin stitch just goes away. Yeah, the butterflies are the same way with this outline, so it's not like this is a weird concept that is out of place, I don't think. And the thing is, once we get those French knots in there, you're probably not going to be able to tell that there's any space there anyway, because that's a lot of French knots for this little space. We might not even do all of them. We'll see how it looks. Yeah, the ladybugs are so small. Yeah, like, you know, they're way smaller than my pinky, and I have, like, the smallest hands ever. Okay, let's see. Let's do the black. And then we'll probably just get... We'll just get these ladybugs done tonight. And then after that, it's just the flower parts. So next time when we have an open time to do embroidery, we will do the taking the fabric salvia off. So I think I'm going to only use two strands here, only because I think three strands are going to be way too big for the French knots here. Oh, yeah, to see where they were. Yeah, from far away like this, like how I am now, it's really difficult to see the little ladybugs, I'm sure. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to do them in this order, too. So I'm going to do the back stitch. Oh, here, let's get in focus. There we go. I'm going to do back stitches for the antenna first. Then I'm going to do satin stitch for the head. And again, that's for the same reason. Like, I don't want to do the satin stitch first, because if I accidentally, on these back stitches, get a little bit into the satin stitch, it's going to split apart my satin stitch. Again, just like kind of how I showed. So I'm going to do those first so that the satin stitch is over the top of it. And then I'm going to do the French knots. And the reasoning I'm not going to do the French knots first is because a lot of times when I pull the thread through and I have French knots, they want to grab onto the French knots. Like, I'll accidentally loop it around a French knot, and that's annoying. I hate that. So typically I save my French knots on a project till the end for that reason. So, all right, I got my two threads here. I'm just going to match them up a little bit more. But yeah, I almost always leave my French knots to the end. I don't know if you guys have experienced that, but it sucks when, like, you got a French knot here, and then you're pulling your fabric through, or your thread through, and then you get, like, a loop like this stuck on one of your French knots. That's, like, just a pain in the butt. So, all right, I'm going to weave this in the back here. I got a little funny loop in here. Hold on. There we go. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't cause a problem, really, because you just catch it, but then you have to go flip the loop around the thing, and, you know, and then if you do it more than once, then it gets super annoying. It's just one of those things that breaks your rhythm. I mean, if you pull really hard, it could maybe cause your French knot to get a funny shape in. Yeah, that's secure. Or you might not see that you've looped it around, and then you've done, like, you know, half of the embroidery, and then you see that you have it looped around a French knot, and that would not be fun either. So I save them for the last. All right, so I'm going to start with two little back stitches for each of these. Oop, drop my needle. I'm doing two instead of one long one, which would be fine too, but I'm doing two because there's a little bit of a curve in these antenna, and I want to make sure I get that. But if you'll notice, so I did just the two strands for this, and it is a little thinner of a line than this big three strand backstitch. So that's, you know, you can really tell between, you know, how fat these stitches are compared to this. That's gonna, you know, I'm using less strands, so it reduces the thickness of the stitch, and that's gonna really help, I think, with these tiny French knots. And it actually is really helping with these antenna too. They're looking pretty cute with the two strands. And I never switch strands like this, like from three strands to two strands in the same embroidery project, until the Splendid Sampler. That was the first time I did anything like that. And now I'm just, now it's just kind of, you think about what your needs are and, you know, do whatever works for that. And that's what we're doing here. So I'll have to do a few more stitches in my satin stitch because I have, it's thinner. Yeah, even two looks big on these antennae. Yeah, one would have been really cute too, for sure. Especially since it's black. Because it's such a dark color, it would have popped out at us anyway, even with a tiny one strand. So one strand might have been the way to go. But I'm okay with it like this. Oh, it's cute with a little filled-in head. I like it. Little guy. Oh, he's cute. I like him. So, all right, there's the head, and now there's 5 French knots in here, which is an awful lot of French knots. I'm going to go vertically like this. So I'm going to try and do it where I don't set my embroidery down for you guys, which is a little difficult. Usually I like to set it on the table so I can have both my hands free to do my looping around. It makes it much easier, but I'm going to try and do it up here with you guys. So I'm holding my hoop with these 3 fingers and then trying to do the stitch with this, so it's a little awkward. But alright, I'm pointing the needle away, going around twice, and then pointing the needle to my stitch. And I'm putting the needle back in a couple threads away. And there, I pulled it tight against the needle there and put my thumb there to hold the loops in place as I pull it through. Otherwise it'll come apart on me and make it knot. And when I can feel it all the way through. Wow, even the 2 strands are like huge knots. I think I'm only going to put 3 knots in here because it's a lot. They're big still. I mean, I could have done 1 strand. I almost think 1 strand would almost be too big. So for this design. So I'm going to just put 3. So 1, 2, and then 1 down here. We'll do the 1 down there next. Actually, no, we'll go up top here. Oops, so we're going to get awkward again here. When you do the pop hoop. Yeah, I really like fabric solving. So we did have that weird issue. Oops. I'm going to drop the hoop. We did have that funny issue with the Fabrisilvy the last time we used it, that it came off a little differently. Like, it was a different texture. Like, Fabrisilvy used to come off, like, in little flecks, so you could see all the little flecks of paper going away. But the last Fabrisilvy batch that we used came off kind of like a goo, like a snotty goo, which was fine if it comes off that way, but it was really difficult to see in an embroidery what has come off or not already. When it flakes off like the paper, you could tell that, oh, there's little paper bits in there. So I like that much better. And the goo, you just never knew. So I didn't know until I was like pressing the, we didn't even do it on embroidery. We did it on when we made that fake fabric out of all my scraps. It just, you could still feel the goo after soaking it and stuff. So, I don't know. We'll see if that's their new thing or not. I don't know. Maybe they changed their formula. I'm not sure. But we'll see. We'll keep our eyes out for that. So, all right, I did 3 little knots, and clearly that's plenty. I mean, with those 3 knots, it's almost completely filling in the space, which I don't want to feel completely filled in. I want them to feel like dots yet, so I'm glad that I just did 3 there. So, all right, I'm going to weave this into the ends, and you know what? I'm going to go ahead and, you know what? It is kind of late though already. We have these 2 yet, but I don't know. We'll see. I think I might just... Yeah, it looks more like a black Black bug. That's why I wanted to make sure that I got that red around the outside. I suppose we could try... Well, in theory, we could try one strand for the next two, but I don't want them to be different from each other, so I think I'm going to just stick with the two strands. I think I'm going to just go ahead and try and finish these other two. I'll just try and get through them faster. I think I hear a little thunder again. Did you guys hear that? It sounded like a plane almost, but I think it was thunder. Like a little slow rumble coming back. All right, let's try and get through these two. I think I'm going to put the antenna on this guy going over this little vine. I think that'd be kind of cute, like he's in front of that vine a little bit. Oh, that's pretty cute. I like it. And then two stitches for this one. Guy's got a little longer antenna than the other guy. And then satin stitch here. Cute itty bitty satin stitches. And it's so funny that just doing the tiny little butterfly and just these itty bitty things it's taking over an hour to do. You know what I mean? Like, embroidery is definitely a just chill and relax and watch some movies and let it progress slowly. It's not something that's enjoyable to rush through, that's for sure. I've had to do some embroideries under like a deadline, and it takes the fun out of embroidery. It's just stressful because it's like, oh my gosh, how am I going to get this done in this amount of time? You forget how long it takes. All right, so I'm going to do just three more French knots here. I don't want to do red. I'm going to set it down to do it because it's just a little easier and faster for me. There. I don't want to do red dots because then I don't think it'll read as a ladybug. I think this will be fine. Once we get the Fabrisilvi out and you see the little spaces in between the knots, I think it'll be okay. Okay, so this is two. And then we'll just get through this last guy quick. So see, like, setting it on the table, it lets me have both hands free, so it's not as fumbly, and I'm able to do the stitching a whole lot faster. So let's weave this in. Again, this one I could have just kind of leapt to the next one, or just wove it, twisted around the backs of the stitches to get to the next one, but again, since it's a dark thread, I don't want to risk it being seen on the front. I'm going to go through here one more time, I think. All right. So you can get... I'm cruising a little bit more now. You can get moving on these things. Once you get in a rhythm. Plenty of thread, too. There we go. start with the antenna again, or antennae, is that the plural? These guys aren't taking all that long. Yeah, and so when we get a chance to work on this again, I will probably do backstitch or a whipped backstitch again. Maybe backstitch, because then it'll go with this backstitch. Backstitch for the stamen, and then I'll fill in these shapes with a bunch of French knots. I think, you know, they'll take, this. These little ones might only take 3 or 4, but there's a couple big ones here. Those might take maybe 5 or 6. And we'll do those with the 3 strands, just to fill in the space quicker, probably. I could do 6 strands to really fill them in quick, but I want to stick to the 3 strands. I mean, I'm really only doing the 2 strands here, so these French knots are a little bit smaller. But we'll get all the insects done. That's good. So I don't know. It feels good to be one more step closer to being finished on this guy. I mean, he'll get done eventually here. Next time we have a free day and we feel like that should be filled with embroidery, this guy's coming up first, because we can get him done in one sitting next time. That will be very cool. All right, there, he's pretty cute. Let's do some French knots on him. I thought I was maybe covering up some of the red, but nope, the red's still there. But see, this is why I didn't have to do satin stitch and all of in for the red. It would just be covered up by these French knots, and it would be splitting the satin stitch so much that it wouldn't even look like satin stitch. Much easier to set on the table. All right, let's weave it in. Oh, they are so little. They are just like little flecks of detail, aren't they? I think it's gonna look really neat once it's all sewn up and in a quilt and all that. They'll just be like these tiny little details that you see from far away and you're like, what are those? And then they're like these tiny little ladybugs. I'm excited. Excited for the little guys. All right, there we are. Yeah, there is sewing on this one. So this one gets, I'll show you the pattern here. This one gets a whole border around it. So we have to sew all these guys on and then triangles yet along all of it. So there's actually quite a bit of work on this one yet. You know, it's not just embroidery on this one. So all right, let's take it out and we'll see what it looks like. Yeah, so this guy won't be done for a while. The embroidery will get done next time we do the embroidery on it. But yep, there is definitely stuff to do on this yet. So I'm just tightening this up. I'm taking it out of the hoop when I'm not using it. Well, first of all, so I can use the hoop if I need it. But if I take it out of the hoop, then there's less likelihood of permanent creasing in the fabric. But there we are! It's pretty! Man, those back stitches that I haven't whipped really jump out at me. I don't know if they do for you guys, but they are like little shiny, little beady looking bits there. So, alright, here it is a little closer. And the little bugs. I think we'll be able to see some of their bodies behind there once we're done. But man, I'm really liking them. I think they're so cute. All right, guys, I'm going to flip you around, and we will call it done for the evening. Thanks for the hearts. All right. Hey, guys. All right, here we are. But yeah, so this is, look how little, how itty bitty these little ladybugs are. So small. But yeah, I'm excited. So yep, then we just have these little stamen guys to do yet. And then yeah, there's all the sewing. So anyway, this will be up on Penguin and Fish Movies. I'll get it started loading tonight, so it should be up by tomorrow morning. And I don't know if you're subscribed to the YouTube, then I think you get an email that says when things are up. But yeah, so thanks so much for coming in. How was I going to do the bugs? Yeah, I think I could have done maybe one strand for those French knots, but I think this is actually going to turn out fine once we take the fabric selvy off and we press it. I think it's going to be nice like this with the two strands. So, all right, guys, I will catch you tomorrow. Oh, it's New Block Thursday tomorrow, so we'll see what's in store for us then. I'll probably have to break out the sewing machine again. It's so nice in the embroidery days because I don't have to set up anything. It's just, just turn on the light and start stitching. That's the fun part about embroidery. No setup. So, all right, I will see you tomorrow, guys. Have a great night.